The story we're about to hear is true. Only the names have been changed to protect the innocent. You're a detective sergeant. You're assigned a robbery detail. A lone bandit robs a jewelry store in broad daylight. He takes $5,000 in precious stones. He's reckless. He's well armed. Your job? Get him.
Dragnet, the documented drama of an actual crime. For the next 30 minutes, in cooperation with the Los Angeles Police Department, you will travel step by step on the side of the law to an actual case transcribed from official police files. From beginning to end, from crime to punishment, Dragnet is the story of your police force in action.
Tuesday, December 2nd. We're still in Los Angeles. We were working a day watch out of robbery detail. My partner's Ben Romero, the boss of Captain Gideon. My name's Friday. It was 1:48 p.m. when I got to the basement of the city hall. The car pulled.
Yo, over here.
Yeah, right. Beverly Boulevard out, huh?
Right.
Want to get the radio?
Yeah, all right.
No report yet?
No, he got away on foot. He headed down 6th Street after the holdup, lost himself in the crowd.
Better watch it, then.
Oh, yeah.
How'd the thief work it? Did you get the story?
There was not much to tell. He walked in the store at the right time, pointed a gun, grabbed a tray full of diamond rings, and walked out. $5,000. Figured he must have had the jewelry store pretty well taped.
And it's like he's had practice.
Well, could be. But sure, one thing, he's well armed.
You get it up, huh?
Yeah.
That's big to get to him.
Yeah, I'll call him. 80K to control one. 80K to control one.
Control one, 80K, go ahead.
80K out for investigation. 3rd and Bixel, 10867.
Roger,
80K. Code 6 to 3rd and Bixel,
10867. That must be it up ahead, Joe. Yeah. Right in the middle of the intersection there, the car turned over.
Mm-hmm. That's all good?
Yeah,
let's go.
Man, stretched out on the street over there, for sure.
Yeah.
I wonder if we can get through here, please.
Excuse me, please. Let us through, please.
Well, let's don't just stand around looking. Did somebody call the police yet? Excuse me.
You involved in this?
Sure, I was in it.
Did anybody call the police?
We're police officers. What happened?
Oh, I'm too glad to see you. Awful lot of trouble.
Well, how about this man here? What happened?
Oh, I slugged him. I had to.
What do you mean?
Well, I don't know what happened. He went a little crazy, I guess.
He pulled this gun on me.
How's he, Jeff?
He's got a bump on the head. Seems to be all right otherwise.
What's your name, sir?
Ernie Brooks. That truck over there, that's what I was driving. I was coming down 3rd Street, and I stopped at the red light over there. That corner over there?
Yeah.
And when the light turned green, I started across the intersection. This guy laying here came barreling down big, so went right through the red light, hit the front of my truck. Flipped his car right over on the side, just like a suit.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, the guy went a little crazy, I guess. Right after the crack-up, I pulled the truck to the curb and got out. This fella here was just climbing out of the top side of his car. Didn't seem hurt at all.
Yeah.
Well, when he saw me coming over to him, he pulled a gun and pointed it at me. Then he turned and started running. I couldn't figure it out.
What'd you do?
Well, as soon as he turned his back to run, I went for him and tackled him. Fought like a tiger. That's why I say I slugged him. I had to, officer. There's something awful funny about the whole thing.
Really, Lego?
Well, look here. There's a box right here. It fell out of his coat when I slugged him. You take a look.
Yeah?
Here. Must be 3 or 4 dozen in there. Rings, all kinds.
Yeah.
Looks like diamonds in them, doesn't it?
The ambulance arrived, and we took the unconscious fuel robbery suspect to Joseph to the receiving hospital. After he was revived and treated for cuts and bruises, we took him back to the city hall of the interrogation room. He fitted the description of the jewelry store bandit almost exactly. He refused to talk. He wouldn't even give us his name. We had his fingerprints taken, and then we had them checked through R&I. The man
was identified as Vern Albert Nicoli, an ex-convict out of Folsom and a two-time loser. He served 1 5-year term for armed robbery and another 3 years for ADW. He checked out the wrecked car he'd been driving and found out that it had been stolen 2 blocks from the scene of the holdup. He had the manager of the jewelry store which had been robbed brought downtown. He identified Nicoli as the bandit. The suspect still refused to talk. Ben and I took him to the main jail, where he was booked on suspicion of 211 DC. 4:15 p.m., he stepped back in at the office.
Takes some of them a long time to learn, sir.
Two-time loser. This one ought to finish him.
I can't figure it. He's been out of Folsom 7 months and going right back in again.
Mm-hmm. Well, we can get the complaint from the DA tomorrow and set the arraignment for Thursday.
Yeah. Let us check with the manager of the jewelry store first. I wonder if Nicoli could have been in those gas station holdups. Remember? Last month?
Yeah. Well, we'll have him in the show up Thursday and see what happens. You want to take care of the arrest report?
Yeah. I'll get out an APB, too. Might turn up some outside jobs on him. I'm still hungry. You still got that candy bar from lunch?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, here you go.
Uh-huh.
What's the matter with you lately, anyway?
I don't know. I've been eating like a horse, standing in the sun. I'll stop.
I'll get it.
What do you got, Joe?
Just a minute. Well, that does it.
What?
Nicoli. He escaped. A broadcast and an all-points bulletin were gotten out on Vernon Nicoli. All units in the vicinity of the escape were alerted. An hour passed. There was no report on the suspect. We checked with the main jail and got the details on the escape. They told us that while Nicoli was being locked up in his cell, he pushed his fingers into the door jamb and had them badly mashed when the cell door closed on them. Both of Nicoli's wrists were then handcuffed, and along with two other ailing suspects, he was taken over to Georgia Street Receiving Hospital by a pair of transportation officers. Going up the stairs to the hospital, Nicoli had turned suddenly, kicked one of the officers in the stomach, slugged the other one, and escaped. It happened at about 4:14 p.m. By 11 o'clock that night, there wasn't a trace of the suspect. 7:30 the next morning, Ben and I checked back in for work. Nicoli was still at large.
Overnight report, Joe. Have a look.
What do you got?
Yeah. Liquor store? Gas station?
Mm-hmm.
Another liquor store. All three of them held up between midnight and 2 a.m. Take a look at the bank description.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. WMA, 5 feet, 950 pounds. Medium build, dark wavy hair, black eyes, fair complexion, deep scar on chin.
How about it?
We didn't waste time getting started again, did he?
It's a pretty big come down if it's Nicoli. Diamond theft, the liquor store.
Well, he had to do something. He didn't have any clothes, no money. How about that car he used on those jobs?
Stolen. We covered early this morning. They're going over to print.
Romero? Joe?
Jibby?
Get on this one right away. We're here just to call a minute ago.
Well, what's that?
Here's the name address. Matthew Hobbs, he runs a candy store near one of the grade schools over in Boyle Heights. He might be able to tell you something.
Yeah, about what?
Nicoli. Saw him last night.
We got in the car and drove over to the Boyle Heights district where we located Matthew Hobbs' place of business. It was a small store on Delray Avenue, 1 block from the neighborhood grammar school. The sign out in front read, New Geneva Candy Parlor and Variety Store. It was the usual display in the window. A wind-up train, a few inexpensive dolls, pencils, writing tablets, and some crepe paper. Inside, the main attraction was 2 long showcases filled with a variety of penny candy. There was a small photograph in the rear of the store, topped with a slab of worn marble. Matthew Hobbs was a small, thin man. He looked to be in his mid-60s. He sat behind one of the counters, filling cellophane bags with Christmas candy while he talked to us. We asked him about Nicoli.
Yes, that's right. Found him here last night. 10 o'clock, 10:15, no later. You want me to help him?
Did you know Nicoli that well, Mr. Hunt?
As well as I know most of the kids that grew up around here. Yes, I guess I knew him well.
Well, what did he ask for in the way of help?
Money, clothes. He's got no family left. I guess I was the only one he thought to come to.
Mm-hmm. Well, how is it that you didn't notify us sooner, Mr. Hunt?
I knew you'd ask. I'd like to explain if I could.
Yes, sir, please.
Did you hand me that stack of bags there, Sergeant?
Uh-huh.
Yes? No, the number 2. Yeah, those, yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right, here you are.
Thank you. As I said, he knocked on my back door about 10 o'clock, and I let him in. I said, just like an animal. Some kind of crazy animal.
Did he have handcuffs on?
Yeah, but the chain connecting him was broken. It made me file off each handcuff.
Yeah.
I went to do it at first. I had an idea what was going on. He said he'd kill me if I didn't help him. But threatening me. I never saw Vernon like that before.
Uh-huh. Go on, Tim.
You know, Sergeant, I knew that boy when he was in grammar school right up the street there. Makes you sit down and think sometimes, huh? Where they grow up and change.
Yes, sir.
Well, what happened after you took the cuffs off of him? He got out of his jail clothes and put on one of my suits. Took what I had in my wallet, $12, and then he kept running around and he found my gun. He took that with him, too.
Mm-hmm. Well, didn't you think of calling for help?
Not the way he acted, Sergeant. Just like a crazy animal. And he'd have killed me if I'd have tried anything. He warned me not to tell anybody he was here. Said he'd come back to kill me if I did. Well, I waited this morning and I called the police.
You said McCauley took a gun from him, Mr. Howden. What kind of a gun was it?
32 automatic. A Colt. I've had it for years. I have it registered with you people. He took just what he pleased. Clothes, gun, money. If you want the truth, Sergeant, I just wasn't brave enough to try to stop him.
Well, when McCauley left here, did you notice if he had a car?
No, he left on foot. Walked across the street and went down that way, toward the town. I don't know. I don't suppose you'll get too far. I hope not.
Do you have any idea who he might try to contact? Some of his old friends, his relatives?
No, he doesn't have any folks I know of. Terrible thing, isn't it? Kids growing up.
Yeah.
The way they change, like McCauley. I don't understand them when they're kids. Seen hundreds of them come through here. Know what they're thinking, how they feel.
Kind of a hobby.
I understand, kids.
Yes,
the trouble is they grow up. All of a sudden they stop being kids.
Yes, sir.
I don't understand them after that.
After we left the candy store, we went back to the office and got out a supplementary APB containing a description of the suspect's clothing and the gun that he'd stolen. Together with Gonzalez and Pena from robbery, Ben and I checked all of McCauley's known friends and his usual hangout. Stakeouts were placed. We got nowhere. The late evening holdup continued. Each of the victims identified McCauley as the bandit. He used the same M.O. in each case. He worked only on the weekends, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday nights. He'd steal a car, pull three holdups in the same general area within an hour, abandon the car in the same area, and then disappear. 2 weeks passed, and then a month. The weekend robberies went on. In the most recent holdup victims, we found out that McCauley had picked up a partner. We checked the man's description to his staff's office. Each of the stolen cars used by the suspects and then abandoned were checked for prints. We failed to identify the second man. The holdup continued. McCauley and his partner were still at large. Monday, January 26th, 8:30 a.m. Ben and I met with Captain Didion.
What's the count, Skip?
The usual. Three holdups Friday, three Saturday, three Sunday. He's proved his point. He's consistent. Now, when do you blow the whistle on him?
We're doing everything that can be done. Stake out, checks and units on duty.
Not enough. The corner pocket wants some results. They want them fast.
How about the times listed for the three stick-ups last night? Have they been double-checked?
No, correct. There's something else for you. Figure it out.
Where is it, Joe?
Well, look here. The drugstore out in West Hollywood robbed at 11:14 p.m.
Yeah?
All right, now this one. Coffee shop out in the valley. Robbed at 11:21 p.m. Both of them the same M.O., same area.
Well, it doesn't fail you. They couldn't have made it from the spot in West Hollywood out to the valley in 7 minutes. It's not possible.
There's a report. Check it.
I know, but how could they do it?
There must be some way to work out the answer. There's got to be.
I can give you a shortcut, yeah.
McCauley, find him. Another 2 weeks passed, and then 2 weeks more. Besides the extra men and units put in service on weekends, 2 dozen separate stakeouts were established in areas where we figured McCauley and his accomplice would strike. Didn't help much. The holdups continued. There was only one difference. The description of the bandit didn't jive anymore. We still didn't have an answer to the superhuman speed that the two gunmen seemed to show in robbing victims at widely separated points, all within a short period of time. We stayed on it. Friday, February 21st. Ben and I took our turn on night space out in a vacant store on Sunset Boulevard. We were assigned to cover a drugstore and a bar directly across the street. We spent 2 weekends on the job. It was quiet. Nothing happened. The third weekend was no different.
One thing's for sure. We never have any luck taking stakeouts.
No, we do.
This empty store must be the grassiest place in town.
Oh, no, no, we've had worse. What time is that?
5:05. A little band over in the bar. Sure, earn your money, don't you?
Loud, anyway. Here, Beth. Have a look. Getting out of the car down the street, actually?
Oh, yeah, they're heading for the bar. What do you think?
Both got dark here. About the same bill.
Looks like they're in a hurry. They're going in the bar.
Oh, come on.
Come on. All right, throw down the guns. Look out!
Now, come on, hands behind your head.
You're not taking me. What are you? All right, hold it right there. Come on, I'm with you. You all right, Ben?
Yeah. You had a good chance. I like both of them. That wraps it up, huh?
Well, you better look again.
Huh?
Neither one of them, Nicole.
Listening to Dragnet, a series of authentic case histories documented from official files.
Many of our corporate customers are worried about employees going wild purchasing office supplies. Staplesrent.com allows them to set up workflow approvals and gives them more control over purchases.
Staplesrent.com and IBM are bringing office supplies and office management together.
I'm Emery Keene of Staplesrent.com, Vice President of Business-to-Business E-Commerce.
Staplesrent took a great idea, a giant step forward.
Staples revolutionized the office supply industry with the superstore.
February 22nd. Ben and I took the two robbery suspects downtown to the city hall to the interrogation room. We questioned Sue R. and I and found that they both had records for burglary and grand theft auto. The car that they'd been using that night had been stolen. After 2.5 hours of interrogation, one of the suspects, a P. Albanez, decided to break down and cooperate. 1 a.m., the interrogation room.
I got something out of it, don't I? Helping you. You're not going to forget I helped you when you get me in court. Most people know about it, Pete, and be making out of court. And I want your story. I knew I never should have went for it. Believe me, it won't happen again. Nicole, you talked me out of it.
Talked into what, Pete?
Helped him out on stick-up. I was his partner in the first one.
After he broke through?
Yeah, that's right. He came to me with a foolproof system, man. And I was sucker enough to go for it.
How long did you work with him?
Just a couple of weekends. 3-4, maybe. I didn't get along with him. No, nobody gets along with him. He's a little crazy, I think.
Who's working with him now?
Oh, I don't know. He's had 2-3 different guys. I don't know who's with him. Say, Sergeant, can I have a drink of water, please?
All right, I'll get you some for you.
How about the way Nicole works? There's 3-4 robberies a night all over town. A lot of guys working, that's all.
Well, they all keep it the same way, huh?
Yeah, sure. When I left them, I went on my own. I picked up a partner and used their system. Pretty good one, huh? Well, it looked like a good one, anyway.
You were working on the weekends, picking up a hot car, dropping a fan.
Yeah, you got it. There must be half a dozen guys in this town working the system. They all got it from Nicola. He taught it to them.
Where do we find him, Pete, you know?
Nicola? No, not for sure. He's our figure, you know. He doesn't live there in town. He only comes up for the weekend. Works Friday, Sunday, and then he takes off again. Takes off for work. Went down by the border someplace, Palm City, Tijuana, I'm not sure. You know, don't forget I'm helping you, huh? We'll let him know I cooperated.
Yeah, we'll let him know, Pete. Now, when's the last time you saw Nicole?
Oh, it's been a month anyway. I never want to see him again. So this may help you, though. I know where his girlfriend stays.
Yeah.
Probably on South Rampart. I can give you the address. He probably goes there once in a while.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else you can think of?
No, that's about it. There won't be any pushover, Sergeant. Like I said, I think he's a little crazy. It's not going to be an easy one to take.
Well, we'll give it a try.
Oh, I mean it that way. He's wild, but you'll get him, I guess. Just one thing.
Sure.
You'll have to tell him first.
3:45 a.m. Pete Albanez and his accomplice were booked at the main jail on suspicion 211-22. The next morning, Ben and I checked out the address of Nicole's girlfriend, which Albanez had given us. The girlfriend's name was Esther Rivard. She told us that she hadn't seen Nicole in more than 2 weeks. We asked her if she knew where the suspect stayed when he was in town. She gave us an address on South Chico. We called in and arranged for a stakeout on the girl's place, and we drove over to check the address that she'd given us. It was a small apartment court on the edge of the industrial district. Nicole wasn't there, neither was the manager. We talked to one of the tenants who told us that the manager, Mrs. Clara Fontaine, was out of town. He said that while she was gone, her daughter Norma was looking after the place. The daughter was employed as a secretary at the Blue Cross Hospital Plan office over on Wilshire Boulevard. We called the office and arranged for another stakeout at the apartment court.
1:25 p.m. We located the landlady's daughter at the Blue Cross office on Wilshire. We showed her Nicole's mugshot.
Yes, it's one of Mama's tenants, Mr. Reynolds. He's in Bungalow 5.
Anyone staying with him or something?
No one's registered with him, no. He has visitors, though. Is there something wrong?
But when did you see this man last?
This morning. When I was leaving for work, he was outside working in his car. I did speak him to.
Sure, go ahead.
Your car. Yes, sir. I see. No, just address the letter to Blue Cross Hospital, son. You can send it to us here at the Wilshire office. That's right. Well, you're welcome. I'm sorry. I hope it's okay to see.
And you told us that you saw this man working on his car this morning.
Oh, yes. He was parked right outside in front. I couldn't very well miss it. I'm going to tell Mama about it when she gets home.
What's that, Miss?
It was certainly strange because it's not that time of year. That's why I noticed it.
What's that?
He was changing the license plate from his car.
Did you get the number?
It's right here in my purse.
1:32 p.m. With the information furnished by the girl, Ben got on the phone and called in a description of the suspect's car, together with the two sets of license numbers. It was a 1941 Ford sedan, dark blue, white sidewall tires. Communications got out a broadcast and a supplementary APB on it. At 6 p.m., Ben and I relieved the men on a stakeout at Nicole's apartment. We waited. No sign of him. We checked with the office on the hour. No sign of the car. 10 p.m. Still nothing doing. 11 o'clock. Nothing. Gonzalez and Pena from robbery drove out and relieved us, and we headed back to the office. 11:26 p.m.
What do you think?
I don't know. It's plugged every hole I can think of.
Things due for a break, isn't it?
Over you. I can use some sleep.
Yeah.
Wait a minute.
Right. Yeah, right away.
Skiller?
Hi. Here's one to move on.
Yeah?
12th and Beacon, southeast corner.
What is it?
Nicole's car. They got it spotted.
11:56 p.m. Ben and I drove to the vicinity of 12th and Beacon, where we checked with a man in Unit 80K who'd spotted the car. They'd gotten out a code 5 on it. The description matched perfectly. A 1941 Ford sedan, dark blue, white sidewall tires. The license number was one of those given us by the apartment manager's daughter that afternoon. Together with the two men in 86K, we staked out on the suspect's car at a distance. It was parked almost exactly in the middle of the block. About 20 feet behind it, a red and white delivery truck was parked. The street was fairly deserted. The only place of business open was a small corner bar at the far end of the block. 12:30. 1 a.m. No one came near the dark blue sedan. We waited. 2 a.m. The corner bar closed up. A man came out, got in the red and white delivery truck, and drove off. 2:30 a.m. The dark blue sedan was still sitting there. We kept waiting.
Roger
13R,
code 7.
Well, one way or the other, I wish he'd make up his mind.
Yeah, it's a long wait.
Cold room here, and it wasn't that vacant store. Well, better check and see if we're clear.
Yeah, right, I'll do it.
80K to Control 1. 80K to Control 1.
Control 1 to 80K. Go ahead.
80K to Control 1. Are we clear?
Control 1 to 80K. Stand by.
Oh, you're on smoke.
I'm out.
You too?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I guess we do without.
Control 1 to 80K. Control 1 to 80K. You're
clear.
Code 1,
KMH-67. 80K to Control 1. Roger. KMH-67.
Hey, have a look, Joe. Just turn the corner.
Yes.
Far end of the block, opposite side. Heading up this way.
Yeah. You make out two of them there?
Mm-hmm.
The two?
They're passing by the sedan.
Oh.
No, are they? No.
They're getting near, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
Come on.
Spotted us, Joe. They're getting out.
All right, hold it there, both of you. Now, Joe. Get up, Nicole.
Behind that car.
Mm-hmm. All right, hold it. Go, go, go.
Throw out your gun, both of you.
Harry, don't shoot. Throw out your gun. I'll kill it. Get up, Harry. I'll kill it.
Come on, throw him out.
Don't shoot. Here's my gun. Don't shoot.
One of them.
Come on, Harry. You got it. Get up.
That's two. Let's go.
Yeah, careful.
Here's a gun. Don't shoot. I got my hand dropped.
All right, keep him up.
Okay, I will.
But don't shoot. I didn't use my gun. Harry did. I tried to tell him you heard me. You heard me.
should. Listen up, this troop. Check my gun. I didn't shoot at you.
Come on. Get him out in front of me.
I guess so. Come on, officer. Third time for me.
All right, say it. Okay, Joe, you ready?
Let's go.
Please, huh? Give me a break.
You picked the wrong time to cry, Mason.
Please, huh? This is the third time for me. I'm no good in that.
You had your chances. You kicked them away.
Let's make a deal, huh? I'm no good in jail. No good at all.
We'll know better out here.
Let's go.
The story you have just heard was true. Only the names were changed to protect the innocent.
On May 24th, trial was held in Superior Court, Department 87, City and County of Los Angeles, State of California. In a moment, the results of that trial. Now... Coley and his accomplices were tried and convicted on several counts of first-degree robbery. They received sentences as prescribed by law and are now serving their terms in the state penitentiary. First-degree robbery is punishable by a prison term of not less than 5 years, with a maximum life term.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Red Cross has been asked by your government to help the nation mobilize for defense. You can help by giving generously to the Red Cross.
Just heard Dragnet, a series of authentic cases from official files. Technical advice comes from the Office of Chief of Police, W.H. Parker, Los Angeles Police Department. The team of...